quote. Can anybody tell me what the slope of this line is?
7 over 3.
7 over 3?
No,
wait. 3 over 7. 3 over 7. So it's important to note that 3 over 7 and 7 over 3 are, they can't both be right. Okay? Because they're not the same number. They can't both be right. One of them is right.
Oh.
So 3 over 7.
And Huntress saying, like, this final answer would be 3 over 7.
Six.
Tyler agrees.
Yes.
We got 6 because one of them 5 is 6, and it's on 6.
No, it doesn't. Like, what the slope is doesn't really, it's related, but doesn't have really anything to do with the coordinates of the point. Like, the coordinates of, just looking at a point's coordinates is not going to tell you the slope of a line.
Right.
Now, looking at the coordinates of both points together, using them together, can tell you the slope, but not just at one point. So this being at 6, it doesn't tell us what the slope is. And it is 3 over 7. Right? So just cut and dry, black and white, the slope is a ratio, which means it's a fraction. Okay? It's the ratio of the change in y to the change in x. How much does y change is in the numerator. How much x changes is in the denominator. Right? If you're not sure exactly what that means, let me further explain. So if we look at this point and we think about moving over to this point, we move in a vertical and horizontal fashion, that'll tell us the slope. So how far is it vertically from this point to that point? Well, I can just go up 1, 2, 3. And now I'm up at the same height, same y value as the second point. So that's the change in y. The change in y is 3 in this case. How much does x change between these two points? It changes this much. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's this 3%. So 3 and the change in x is 7. Basic thing, if I ask you what the slope of the line is and there's 2 points, just look at those 2 points and figure out how much does the y change, how much does the x change between those two, and the change in y or the change in x is what we call the slope. Okay? Callie?
Sorry, just talking.
1 and 2.
James.
3 over 7, good? Let's look at another one. After you do that, I want to remind you what the slope of a line means. Okay, it's an important number. And we don't want it to just be some random number. Okay, we want to know what it really means. Let's look at this graph. Again, we've gotten a little bit of a refresher. Let's try again. Tell me the slope of that line. Okay, so everybody take about 12 seconds or so.
Over 3.
6 over 3. Let's see if we all agree at that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. We start here. We're gonna look at. Let's look at the horizontal change first, because it doesn't really matter. Okay. So we go over 1, 2, 3. If I go over 3, am I right? You know, am I the same horizontal as the second point? Yes, I am.
Yeah. So
that's the change in x. And then let's just double check the change in y. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I did it.
Voila.
Yeah, Kelly!
I can't
believe
Kelly.
Kelly, we all did it. So.
Hey.
I got it.
Good work. Good work. We are all losing our minds and talking when I am talking.
No.
Do you have a question? You have a question?
Okay.
Cool.
No, I don't have a question.
Okay. It's good to ask questions in the class, because if you have a question, I bet you a lot of other people have the same question. If you ask somebody else a question, you're being distracting to everyone. So let's just ask questions to the class. 6 over 3. If it's 6 over 3, can that be simplified? 6 divided by 3.
Yeah. 3 over 2.
2 over 1. Now, that's the same as 2. If you just write 2 and say the slope is 2, then you're correct. It's a little bit easier to think about when you write over 1, because remember the slope. It tells me how much to do, how far to go vertically and how far to go horizontally. So I can go up 6 and to the right 3, or I can go up two, one, two, and to the right one. Certainly seems to, you know, like, be valid instructions for finding another point on the line. It looks like I am on the line still. If I go up another two and over one, there we go, I'm right there on the line still. Up two and over one. And now, with using like these little baby steps, we've got up a total of six and over three, just like six and over three steps. So this line could have a slope of six over three, two over one, four over two, 12 over six, 14 over seven. You should be able to do any of these vertical and horizontal changes and still find another point on the line. So if I were to go up two over one, up four over two, up six over three, up eight over four, there we are, another point in the line. Yeah?
I was looking at the one we just did, and, oh wait, are we going to do another one of these?
We're going to do several more. Yeah.
Okay, I want to wait and see about something.
Okay. Well, we're going to do another one, but this time, I'm also going to point out what the coordinates of each of these points are. So this one's at 1, 9, and this one's at 9, 5. Change because y is vertical over the horizontal change because x is horizontal. So I can start here and go down to that point, go from this point to that point, it doesn't matter which way I go. But if I start here, then let's talk about the horizontal. How much horizontally, if I go from this point over to this point, how much did I move horizontally? How much did x change? How much?
Nine?
Nine? Can we read nine?
I see eight.
Nine. Eight.
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 Well, let's count it off to start with.
Eight.
All right, we just want to figure out how far is it from here to here. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Looks like eight.
Oh, yes.
And from right here to here, it's eight. Oh. That's the horizontal change, so that goes in the denominator, eight. All right, so we have to go over eight. Now, how much do we have to go vertically?
Four.
Four.
Which way?
Down.
Down. So, if we go down four, how do I show that it's a down four, not an up four?
Negative.
Four. Okay, negative four. David, are you onto something?
Yeah, I was just doing a couple more on my paper. And I found that if, like, you could always make a triangle, or not a triangle, a rectangle out of the lines.
Okay, so if I am guessing at what you're saying.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you just count out.
So it's the same as what we did, but it's kind of a visual guide to make sure you don't get off track. You can just count how long this is and how long this is. This would be the change in x. This would be the change in y. If I were to go this way, this would be the change in y. This would be the change in x. So if you draw a little rectangle, it could help you keep on track and not get off and count the wrong amount or something like that. Now let's talk about this. It's, you know, we had some nines, we had some eights. Let's see if there's a let's try this. What if I were to say, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a couple of points down and draw a line. But it's going to be, I'm going to make it a real hassle to count how far apart these points are. So let's say that this guy here is at 13, comma, kind of realistic, maybe 38. Okay, and this guy here is at 64, comma, the reason I'm doing this, the reason why math teachers do things like this, is to move you from, move you away from what maybe feels comfortable and to maybe move towards something that's a little more
aggressive,
a little more calculating, okay? Well, what this does for us is it allows us to kind of make a formula that works all the time in every situation, and that even though we're having to kind of learn something new, it turns out it's a little bit faster if we learn this new way. It might take a little longer the first 3, 4, 5 times, but once you get it down, it's actually a lot faster to do this than it is to count. Okay? So if we were to, like Jaden said, if we were to draw this rectangle thing, and then count. Those numbers aren't huge, they're not astronomical, so to count wouldn't take too long, but I'd have to count all the way from here up to there, right? I'd be counting a lot. All right. I'd have to count 38, I'd have to make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, until I get all the way up to 124. Does that make sense? Just count from here, starting at 38 and go up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What's that now?
Can't you just subtract?
Yes, good. Why not just subtract it? No reason not to. If I want to know how far it is from here to there, why not subtract?
That's what I did.
It's a good idea, right? So if I want to know how far it is from here to there, instead of counting and counting and counting for a long time, let's just subtract. Subtract what?
124 minus 38.
Okay. So we didn't count it, but we're definitely going to figure out how far it is from here to there. Now we need to figure out how far it is from here to there. How do we figure out how far it is from here
67
to there? What's that?
64 minus
38. That does look a lot.
Oh, I thought it was a
17.
Yeah,
I meant 64. 64 minus what?
13.
Minus 13. 13. Okay. So, to try and get you to resist the urge to just count off the slope, as many students do, okay, I made the numbers big so that you could see what you would do to calculate how far it is from here to there vertically, how far it is from here to there horizontally. And so, has anybody done that? 124 minus 38?
It is 86 over 51.
Interesting slope here. Let's see. I'm trying to think if we can simplify it. Obviously, we don't have a 2 in common. 86 is not divisible by 3, so they don't have a 3 in common. Or a 4. Obviously, not a 5. Or a 6. Perhaps a 7. But no, not a 7. 51 times 4 by 7. 8, no, 9, no, 10, no, 11, no, 12, no, 13.
Maybe.
No.
I don't think so. I think this is not going to be a fraction that simplifies. 51 divided by, this doesn't make sense. And by going to 13, we've gone much farther than we need to in checking if these have any common factors. So it doesn't simplify. 86 over 51 is as good as it gets. If I want to go up and over to get to another point without, like, using fractions or decimals, they have to go all the way up, and up 86 and over 51 to get to the next point that lands, like, right on the grid of the graph. So what is 86 over 51? Tell me about the line. 86 what?
86.
Okay, go up 86.
And then
horizontal
51.
What's that?
Horizontal
51. Go to the right 51. Okay. Vertical change, a change in y over a change in x. Right? Y is vertical, x is horizontal. Change in y over a change in x. So can we do the subtraction approach, even if the numbers are a little smaller?
Mm-hmm.
Of course. Why not? So let's find the slope of this guy. Maybe you could still count it, but also try and calculate it and verify that you're calculating it correctly. By calculate, I mean do the subtraction little thing that we suggested.
Yeah.
All right, so if we use these 2 points, we move vertically from here to there. We start out vertically at 1, and then we end all the way up here at 10. All right, so how far did we move vertically?
9.
You can show that by doing 10
minus
1. Minus 1, right? We might have 10. Let's take out that 1. We'll be left with the distance between the two. Okay, let's look at horizontally. We started here. Where is this horizontally? Where is this point? At 8. And we move over to until we're at 11. Okay. So 11 minus
8
gives us that 3. So 10 minus 1 is 9.
Over 3.
Over 3. So we've gone up 9 and to the right 3, or we go to the right 3, up 9. And then 9 over 3, what's that?
3 over 1.
Okay, so I forgot to do this for a couple of these. Let's remind ourselves what the slope means. It's not just how to get to another point from one point, how to get from one point to another. It means something, right? To help you remember what it means, let's say that x represents minutes, and y represents a number of cars. Okay, so maybe this is the number of cars that go through a drive-through at a bank. Okay. So what does this slope tell us about the number of cars that go through this drive-through at the bank?
It goes 3 cars.
3 cars every minute.
That's a good
9 minutes.
Or another minute. That is a crazy bank.
Is there like?
What does 9 over 3 tell us about the cars at the bank?
9 cars every 3 minutes.
Okay? But that's, of course, to say that 9 cars went through in 3 minutes is the same as to say 3 cars went through in 1 minute. And that's what the slope means. It's a rate of change. A rate of change. What's changing here? What's changing in this scenario?
How many cars?
The number of cars is changing. Right. How fast is the number of cars changing?
3.
Every 1 minute. It's changing 9 cars every what?
3 minutes.
It's changing 15 cars every
5 minutes.
Yeah. That's the rate of change of cars versus time. Okay, very good. So, all on your own, you guys have tapped into this formulaic way of finding the slope.
Mm-hmm.
This formulaic way of finding the slope. By formulaic, I mean we use subtraction. Rather than just counting, we use subtraction. I'm going to find the slope of this line using subtraction, but I'm going to find it incorrectly. Okay? And I want you to spot my mistake. I'm going to take 10, minus 6
mm-hmm.
over negative 6 minus 8.
That's
not
good. That was incorrect.
What?
It was actually 8 minus
Four.
6.
Over negative
you have to do it. And since you started with the 10 first.
Start with the 10 first.
And you minus 6. Then you have to start with the 8 first because since we're like a pair.
You're absolutely right. That's what I should have done. Or if I had negative 6 minus 8, I would have to have, what would I have to have in the numerator? 6 minus 10.
Yeah.
Now let's see what happens when I get this wrong answer and how I can know what's wrong. 10 minus 6 is 4. Negative 6 minus 8 is negative
14.
Okay, so this is a negative number because a positive divided by a negative is what?
It's
a negative. So we have negative 4 over 14. How do I know that can't be the slope of this line? Other than you pointed out that I did it incorrectly, all that kind of stuff. But what's something that very clearly I can see that this couldn't possibly be the slope of this line that looks like this?
It's going up.
It's going
that's
up.
That's a negative number.
Negative.
Now we will go down.
So this kind of a line should have
a positive number
as the slope. Positive slope. And if it had a negative slope, what would that look like? If my line had a negative slope.
It'll go down.
It'll be going down like that.
Also, the 8 would be a positive, so it would be a negative 6 plus 8. So, but negative 6 minus 8.
Nope.
It was right. The equation was set, but it would.
Nope. If I subtract 8, I subtract 8.
Yeah. So negative 6 is going up 8. So.
I see what you're saying, but if I do, like, if I do negative 6 minus 8, just because I can see what's supposed to happen doesn't mean that it changes a minus 8 to a plus 8. Let me show you how I should have done it, and maybe then we'll see that thing that you're talking about happening. So what I should have done, since I did 10 minus 6, I should have done 8 minus what?
6.
Six.
Not quite.
No.
Negative
6. 8 minus negative 6. Now what happens when I subtract a negative?
It's just plus.
It's just the same as adding. Subtract a negative is the same as adding. So this would be 4 over 8 plus 6. That's 4 over 8 plus 6. That's 4. That's a positive 14. Positive. So where I got a negative, mistakenly, incorrectly, should have got a positive 14. And that's what's going to happen if you switch those things around. If you get those in the wrong order, are you going to get a negative where you should get a positive, or a positive where you should get a negative? So 4 over 14. Let's double check and make sure that that is the slope. Okay. How can I check and make sure that the slope is 4 over 14? How do I look at this line and make sure that the slope is 4 over 14?
Count.
Yeah, let's count it off just to double check. So the 4 tells me that I should be able to start at this point and go what?
4 up.
1, 2, 3, 4. Is that right?
Right,
yeah.
14.
And go right 14. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
You're
right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Now 4 over 14, can that be simplified?
No.
Yeah, I can.
No, I can't.
Never mind.
Yeah, I can.
Divide by 2, we get 2 over 7.
Shucks.
2 over 7. So that means that I should be able to go up 2 and where?
Over 7.
Over 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And that also gives me another point on the one. I should also be able to go up 1 and over 3.5. 1, 2, 3.5. There we go. There's another point. So the ratio stays the same. If I go up 1, I have to go over 3.5. Go up 2, I go over 7. If I go up 4, I have to go over 14. The ratio is always the same. Let me show you another thing on this one. If I mix it up, I get these things kind of switched, okay? It can still be absolutely fine. If I do 6 minus 10, as long as I then I started with a 6, so I start with a negative 6 in the denominator, negative 6 minus 8. 6 minus 10 over negative 6 minus 8. Let's see. What's 6 minus 10?
Negative
4. Negative 4. Now you you might think, stop talking, please. You might think, hey, I got negative 4. I know that the slope is positive 4 over 14, so I must have done something wrong. But let's see what happens in the denominator. What's negative 6 minus 8?
Negative 14.
Now, what's a negative divided by a negative?
Positive.
So this also is positive 4 over 14, which is also positive 2 over 7. Here's a way that you can double check and make sure you got things squared up and in the right order as they should be. If I look at these two, right, this guy, since it's a change in y over the change in x, this should be a y, and this should be an x. What do you notice about this x and y? And I look at the graph.
X is negative.
Well, x is negative, like this x is negative 6. And what's the y here?
Positive 6.
6, right? So negative 6, 6. These are the coordinates of one of the points. And if I look at these two, those are the coordinates of the other point. So if I set up this subtraction here and I look at the, if I look vertically here, each of these should pair up and be the coordinates from each of the points. If I've done it wrong and I've got it switched, then I'll find the x of one point here and the y value over there, and it'll be all mixed up. Starting to get the idea, we can sort of, instead of having to count it off, yeah, we can just subtract the y value, subtract the x value, so we can find the slope that way. Alright. So, is that my last one? That was my last one. Let me just remind you real quick, we pretty much already went through this, but here's another quick little check that I actually made you try. What kind of a slope does this line have? This, oh, come on.
What?
Pretend it was straight.
No, they're like millions lines.
Really, really nice. Positive slope, what kind of slope does this have?
Negative.
What kind of slope does this have?
Positive.
Parallel.
Positive.
It's supposed to look perfectly flat.
Parallel.
Parallel.
It can't be parallel, there's nothing to be parallel. It's not a positive. It's not negative.
So it's
what number is not positive or negative?
Zero.
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 Are you going to win a trophy now?
You want that golden star?
Now, let's just see why it's zero exactly. If I look at this point and this point. Stop talking. If you're talking, here's a little test. If you're talking, don't talk.
What?
Okay.
What?
If you think about your mouth and there's noises coming out of it, you know you're talking, and then that will tell you that you should stop. Okay. Now, between these two points, there's something that doesn't change. What is it that's not different
Zero.
About these two points?
No, it's the same value.
Up or down,
okay. So Tyler has put it into a little bit of a longer sentence. They both have the same y. Right? Same y? Oh, well, these all have this. They're all in the same line. But this one, these two have the same y value. Right? If this is the y value of 3 and I go flat, right over to this other one, this one also has a y value of 3. So how much does the y change between these two points? Yes, the y does not change. So when you think about the change in y or the change in x, y has not changed at all. Zero change in y. So the x changes, but here's the thing. It doesn't matter how much x changes. Because what happens when you divide 0 by a number? What do you get?
Zero.
It's like I have 0 cookies divided among 3 people. How many cookies does everybody have?
None.
Zero.
None.
If you ask, you're going to
do it. So, Zero divided by any number is still zero. So we have a zero slope. This guy, though. These 2 points, remember that little test I told you about? That there's noise coming out of your mouth. You know that you're talking, and you know immediately what you should stop doing. So these 2 points, they have the same what? They have the same x. So x, when we think about the change in y or the change in x.
But isn't that?
Now it's gone. Well, I think what you're seeing, and maybe having trouble putting words to it, only y is changing. It's just all y, right? There's just all y changing and no x changing. So when we think about it as a slope, we see a change in y. The only change is y.
Oh.
And no change in x.
Okay.
So now we have, as a slope, as a number, as a ratio, as a fraction, we have a number over 0. Now what do we get when we divide by 0?
No.
Something divided by 0 does not exist. There is no way to define division by 0. So when we say divided by 0, we say that that number is undefined. There's no way to conceptualize dividing by 0. There's no way to make sense of dividing by 0. There's no way to define what that number would be if we divided a number by 0. So it's undefined. So this is a positive slope, negative slope, a zero slope, and an undefined slope. So if somebody told you that a line had an undefined slope, you would know that it goes right, straight, up, and down vertically, okay, because there's no change in x. So no change in x means there's a zero in the denominator. So remember what slope is. Slope tells me how far up I can go and over to find another point on the line. And we reviewed that if there's a negative in that slope, that means that if the negative is in the numerator, we're going to go down. If the negative is in the denominator, we're going to go left, because those aren't negative. And we found out that we can use this subtraction idea to, rather than counting the slope, we can calculate the slope using subtraction.